So hello again, everybody, and welcome to Integrated Arts. Tonight, I am so excited because we have our music subject matter expert with us, Dr. Richard Anatone, and he's a professor of music therapy and coordinator of applied music lessons at Prince George's Community College. Yes?
Music theory.
Oh, I'm sorry, music theory. It does say that.
Very different program.
Absolutely. And he earned his bachelor's degree in piano performance from Rhode Island College and his master's and doctoral degrees in piano performance with cognates, meaning essentially connected studies, in theory composition from Ball State University, which is in Indiana. At PGCC, he teaches a variety of music theory classes in both the traditional and commercial programs, as well as piano and composition lessons. He is the faculty advisor for, is it MAGIC?
Yeah, MAGIC.
Okay, so faculty advisor for MAGIC. It's an acronym that stands for what in particular?
Music and Game Innovation Club. They came up with it.
Gotta love that. But anyway, this is a student-run club that he helped found, and it's dedicated, as he said, to the performance and composition of music and video games. We're going to hear a little bit about that tonight. Now, another thing about Dr. Anatone is his research interests include structural unity, semiotics, and humor within video game soundtracks. And he has presented his research at a variety of conferences, including the North American Conference on Video Game Music and Music and the Moving Image. He's the editor of the upcoming book, like completely fresh off the presses today, pretty much. That's called The Music of Nobuo. Please say that for me. I'm going to mess it up again. Nobuo Uematsu, and in the Final Fantasy series. And this is due for publication in spring 2021. So, Integrated Arts, future teachers, please join me in welcoming Dr. Anatone.
Hello, thank you. Today, I'm going to go over the musical topic and thematic transformation in the role-playing game. So I'll give you a very brief overview, I mean, like incredibly brief, on the concept of semiotics and symbolism and signs. And then we'll go very briefly into the musical topic. And then we will just go right into musical affect through the leitmotif in video games, mostly the role-playing game. Basically, this is a branch of study of musical semiotics. And if you don't know anything about semiotics, semiotics is a study of signs and symbols and their interpretation. And although I'm studying musical semiotics, the idea of musical semiotics goes back to a philosopher by the name of Charles Peirce. And he was an American theorist of logic, communication, language, and signs. And he really kind of began the foundation of our modern understanding of signs and symbols. And how we as human beings interpret signs and symbols. And a sign can really be anything. A sign can be anything that communicates meaning to people. And there are many, many complicated ways that this philosopher kind of came up with how we can understand a sign. But when it comes to understanding music, the most, I'd say the most appropriate level of signs is what he would refer to as the second level. And there are three different types of signs in the so-called second level of sign: the icon, the index, and then the symbol. The icon is a sign that actually physically resembles what it's representing. So if you consider any picture that you see on your screen, I mean, you see on Zoom, if you bring your mouse all the way to the bottom, you'll see a video camera. And that video camera means we're going to show or we're going to hide your video. So that little symbol, or that little picture rather, is actually an icon. It resembles physically what a video camera looks like, and so we would consider that an icon. If you open up MS Word and you see a picture of a folder, that folder represents opening an actual file, like a folder in your file cabinet. And so that's why it means open. So all these pictures that actually resemble something is essentially an icon. Now, when we get into the second and the third layer of signs, it goes away by one step away from physical representation. So while an icon resembles what it's supposed to represent, an index bears connection. And so although smoke isn't fire, it's an index of fire, because smoke is going to indicate that there's probably fire nearby. If you hear a dog barking in the distance, that bark that you're hearing is an index of a dog being nearby. So these don't actually represent what you're seeing physically, but they are an index because they bear connection to what they represent. The third level of sign is completely arbitrary, and that is the symbol. A symbol is completely arbitrary, and we understand its meaning through cultural norms. And so, for instance, red means stop. Why? And of course, if you have a 3 or 4 year old child, you say red means stop, and they'll look at you and say, why? It's like, you know, that's a very good question. Why does red mean stop and green mean go? I don't know. I was told that if I don't stop at a stop sign, I'll have to pay money. That's why red means stop and green means go. So any type of sign that has complete arbitration, in other words, it has nothing to do with what it really represents, but we just kind of understand it by rule or law, that would be considered a symbol. So as you can see, the icon physically resembles, the index bears connection to what it represents, and then the symbol is just completely arbitrary. Why does the octagon mean stop? Well, because we have decided that an octagon should be stop and a triangle should be yield. I mean, these signs are symbolic because we just associate or we put meaning to them. So those are the three levels of sign that we see in his second layer of signs. When we compare that to music, the musical topic is a form of sign. A topic is a branch of musical semiotics. And there's been a lot of study and a lot of interest in the last maybe decade or two of musical topics and musical semiotics. Some of the more prominent scholars in this field include Robert Hatton, Raymond Minnell, Kofi Agawu, David Lidov, Brian Alamon. These scholars are looking at music, whether it is by Beethoven, whether it's 300 years before for Beethoven, or even looking at contemporary music, music in pop culture, all types of music. They're looking at how we interpret sounds and music and whether or not we're able to see more hidden meaning in that kind of music. And especially when it comes to film and media studies like video games, it's becoming a very, very popular branch of musical semiotics. Essentially, a musical topic, according to Robert Hatton, is, quote, a complex musical correlation originating in a kind of music used in a larger work. That's a very complicated way of saying a musical topic is music or sound that represents something that is not music or sound. So it's a symbol, or it is a sign, or it is some kind of index or icon. Musical topics can be all of these. And that's really what we're interested in when we're looking at musical topics. So rather than giving you all the different kinds of musical topics, I'd like to actually engage in a little bit of a conversation with you. What I'm going to do is we're going to play Name That Topic before we get into my branch of video game music studies. I'm going to play some examples, and I'd like for you to contribute to the question of what instruments do you hear, how fast — the word tempo means fast or slow — the key, does the music sound bright or dark, comment on the melody and the rhythm. And then once we kind of look at all these parameters, we will be able to identify exactly what kind of musical topic we're listening to. Now, you might immediately hear this and say, I know exactly what that is. But the question is, why do you hear and know what this is? Well, it's because of the instrumentation, the tempo, the key, the melody, the rhythms. All of these parameters are going to have some kind of sign that point to the musical topic. So why don't we take a listen, and then I'm going to ask anyone to be able to contribute to the question of what instruments do you hear? So who can tell me what types of instruments? You can all, maybe if you want to unmute yourself, that'll be fine. Just let me know, what instruments can you recognize in this excerpt?
Some trumpets.
Okay, trumpets, good. Anything else?
Clarinet.
Good, winds and, okay, so trumpets, clarinets, what else?
Flute. There was like some cymbals.
Okay, cymbals, excellent. And someone said flute. Someone
We've said got drums in the chat.
Great. These are all correct. We have brass, like trumpets. We have piccolos and flutes, snare drums, and some of the different kinds of drums, and other percussion. Good, very good. Would you say this is incredibly fast, a moderate tempo, or slow? What would you think?
Fast,
okay. Is it really, really fast, or is it kind of a brisk tempo? One, two, one, like, two.
Like brisk.
Okay, good. So I would say not too fast, but also not too slow, right? I mean, if it was really fast, this one is a little bit more on the laid back kind of brisk. Good. Would you say that the music is bright or dark?
Bright.
Good. Yeah. That we're using are in the bright major key. Now, when we comment on the melody, do you hear a lot of, and I'm going to use, bring up my, I can't bring up my keyboard, but if we take a listen to the melody, I'm going to play it on the keyboard. The notes that I'm using are outlining a triad or a chord. They are actually farther apart than steps. So if I play a scale for you, now if I skip every other note, and then I play those notes, I have a skip that outlines a triad. So a lot of times we have these melodies that can either be stepwise, which means we're using a melody where all the steps, are, the notes rather, are very close to each other, but we can also use outline chords. Now the rhythms, I'm just going to show you on the screen. The rhythms that we see on the screen are actually all of these rhythms are indicative of a particular kind of music. So what type of topic? What is this? What kind of music is this? It's not a love ballad, but what would you say this is?
Classical.
Okay, good. It is from the classical era. It is a piece of music written by Beethoven. But if I were to ask you the style, what does it sound like?
Chamber music.
Good. So it is a chamber piece. It's a little bit smaller than an orchestra. Someone said in the chat, it reminds you of war music. Interesting. Why war music?
It sounds more like you're announcing, like an announcement when you announce kings and stuff.
Okay. So someone said in the chat what they would play before battle, and you say something about reminding you of kings and queens. This is very interesting because this is a march. This is a march. And so marches, if you think, if you've ever seen like a reenactment of a Civil War band or the Revolutionary band, they always had snare drums, brass, and piccolos or flutes. These instruments all combined with each other tells us that this is a march. And so marches, someone in the chat, can you remove your bard? I don't know what that means, but I could possibly do, is this better?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, that was me. Yeah, there you go. Some of the stuff is missing, and it was a typo.
Do you see the names? Oh, I didn't realize.
No, not the names. We just see a gray box. So
okay, good to know.
Yeah, I'll get you on the chat messages.
Cool. Thanks.
You're welcome. Teamwork.
So this is a march. A lot of marches are going to be all of these. In other words, a lot of marches are going to use snare drums. That's why I put this in bold. If you hear snare drums in the symphony orchestra, they're probably trying to conjure up this image of a march or a military band or even soldiers marching off to war. And of course, we often associate war with politics, either presidents or kings and queens. So that's why all these images are conjuring up in your head, even though you might not have said, oh, that sounds like a march. You associate it with things that we often associate with marches. And so if you hear music that has all of these different signs, all of these musical signs, then you're going to associate it with what we call the march topic. So the parameters above, as you can see, indicate a march in the music to the listener. They act as signs to the musical topic, or to the actual topic, which is, in this case, a march. So does this make sense? Are there any questions on these different musical signs that kind of point us to this is a march? Because we're gonna go over a few different topics before we get into the music that I'd like to discuss.
So feel free to either be audible, give us use your voice, or either use your thumbs up or yes. Okay, we got some yeses that are coming in.
Cool. Excellent. All right. So let's go on to the next topic. So this is actually quite similar. And that, I did this specifically. This is a similar kind of topic. I know this is a very small video, but if you can kind of watch what this guy is doing, I'm going to show you play a quick excerpt. Obviously, this is only one instrument, but if I were to play, and you can see that it's a brass instrument, and it's actually interesting because it's a very long, we don't really see this kind of trumpet anymore. It's a much longer instrument. I can't even see if I believe he's playing some keys, but this is more like a natural trumpet. So I'm going to play this excerpt over here in this corner, and it's for the orchestra, but you're going to probably notice that there are some kind of similarities between the two. Now, we've all heard this, I'm assuming. So what instruments can you make out in this prominently? What instruments are most featured in the excerpt that I just played?
Cymbal.
Say that again, I'm sorry?
Cymbal or
something. You're cutting out, I'm sorry. I can't hear what you're saying.
She said cymbal.
Oh, cymbal, yeah. Good. Yeah, cymbal crashes, yeah. Excellent. Yeah, cymbal crashes. What else do we hear?
Right, the gong drums, you know, that big bass drum, boom, boom, boom.
Yeah, the big drum like this big that you whack. Yes, you get a very thunderous sound. What else do we hear?
A trumpet.
Lots and lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of trumpets. As a matter of fact, lots of brass, right? So you have lots of brass. We hear what you were saying, the cymbals and the bass drum. Good. Is this slower or faster than the march that we were listening to?
Slower.
It is slower. Just slightly enough.
Yeah, just slightly, but we still have a slower tempo, and so we're not going to get that energetic kind of we're marching off to battle, even though there's some similarity with what we're listening to. It's not too fast, it's not too slow, but it is slower than the march. Would you say that this is bright or dark?
Bright.
It's bright, and it makes sense because we're trying to probably instill some kind of positive effect to our listeners. The melody, let's see. Or the C, D flat, so. You kind of hear this in the background played by the trumpets. And we also hear the opening sounding like this. The notes that I'm playing, again, are outlining a triad. So you might hear some similarities between this and the march, but this isn't a march. You really couldn't march to this. This is a little bit too slow. And so instead of being a march, this is actually referred to, does anybody know the term we use for this?
Introduction?
It is. And what are we trying to introduce?
The king.
A king, yeah. Oh. I mean, especially this guy right here, right? This guy's totally introducing a king.
Sounds royalty all over it.
Good, royalty all over, excellent. This is known as a fanfare. If you've ever heard the term fanfare, that's what this is. A fanfare is a short piece of music. In this case over here, the guy only played for about half a minute, Although this piece is played at the beginning of the Olympics, we typically only listen to the first minute or so.
Mm-hmm.
It's a 4-minute piece. Yeah, it's not too long. 4 minutes isn't long in the world of music, especially when you have a Mahler symphony that can last an hour and a half. A fanfare is a brief piece of music that usually is very celebratory. It is very victorious. It's usually going to be in the bright key. And you'll notice that the rhythms here have a little three under it. If you can't read music, that's fine. If you can read music, that's great. The three is a triplet. So a triplet is ta 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 1 2 3 1 2 3. It can also be played faster. Da 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 ba 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 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 ba. So when we listen to this excerpt again, you'll hear. But underneath that, you'll hear these trumpets going da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And you'll hear this interesting triplet figure that's very often associated with the fanfare. So that very slow, regal, and also fast triplet figure in the background, that's all indicative of what we call the fanfare topic. So we have a march topic, we have a fanfare. They're very similar, but one's a little bit faster and uses ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta duple rhythms. And the fanfare is a little bit slower, but it uses triplet rhythms. Someone said it has regality all written all over it, right? Royalty. And that's pride, sense of regal or royalty. Fanfares are introducing very specific instances of things that are supposed to be associated with pride and honor and grandeur. So we've got the topic that is the march, and we've got a topic that is more like a fanfare. If you've ever played any of the Final Fantasy games, they're still making them. Final Fantasy 16 is slated for next year for the PlayStation 5 and the PlayStation 4. But these are games that when you win a battle, this is the first thing you hear as soon as you win the battle. Now that, has anyone heard that tune before?
Yeah.
Yes.
We got some yes and yups.
So ta 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 ta, that rhythm at the beginning, ta 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 ta, that's a fanfare rhythm. And so obviously it would make sense that once you've won your battle that you would play. In Final Fantasy IV, it was the first time that we had real live samplings of instruments. And so every instrument that you would expect in this fanfare, like brass and percussion, you get. They use the same melody in every single Final Fantasy every time you win. And in this case, we hear brass and percussion with that same melody. The last topic we're going to look at is very, very different. And the reason why I want to look at all three of these is because when you...
Excuse me, Dr. Anatone, someone said that brought back memories.
Oh, good. good. I'm glad. Because this entire lecture is probably going to bring back some memories in. The other topic is very, very different. And why I'm contrasting these is because in video games and in film especially, those two kind of things that have narratives that you play through or that you experience, we can take a single theme and we can transform it from one topic to the next, even though it's the same music, and completely change the overall affect for our listeners. So this is a different topic. I'd like for you to think about what instruments you can hear, and we'll try to associate what topic or style this is in.
Thank you.
make out in this?
Clarinet.
Okay, clarinet. That's actually a
oboe.
It's a flute, but the reason
it's kind of someone said flute in the chat.
Yeah, it sounds like it's kind of a fake flute because these were electronic samples. So it's kind of a distorted, but good. It's a woodwind instrument. Good. What else do we hear?
Violin.
Good. Lots and lots of strings. As a matter of fact, that's pretty much it. We have
triangle
or woodwinds, and then we also have strings. Someone else said something in the chat?
Triangle. Oh,
good. Yeah, that little triangle.
That stuck out for me.
Good. Yeah. Well, I mean, because it doesn't have the same color as everything else, right? You hear all this music, and then ding, like, oh. Yeah. That's a very special meaning. Good. Would you say it's fast or slow?
Slow.
It's very slow. Good. Very slow. And the key is also quite bright. The melody, however, does not have all those skips. Instead of going all those skips that we hear in the march and in the fanfare, we hear notes that are close together. But almost every single note that I'm playing is only one step next to the other note. And so there's a lot of stepwise motion and a lot of repeated notes. The notes also, in terms of their rhythm, are very, very simple. We don't hear ta 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 ta. We don't hear ta 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 ta. We hear ta 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 ta. It is very long note. It's very simple rather, and we have a lot of long notes in our melody. So it's a very simple rhythm. And it's a very simple and very lyrical melody. And so we refer to this maybe not so much as a topic, but a style that we like to call the singing style. The singing style is very, very lyrical. It is very different, obviously, than what we were listening to before. But when we hear this kind of music, even though it's instrumental, there's clearly no one singing here. We refer to this as the singing style because the melody is so lyrical. And so instead of giving you a sense of pride or a sense of energy or a sense of grandeur with regality, what type of affect do you think that this kind of music would have on your listener? What are some affects? Anyone?
Could make them feel positive.
Okay, positive. What are some other adjectives that you could use to describe this kind of music?
Dr. Anatone, someone asked if you can play it again.
Absolutely. Oh, I'm sorry.
Hope.
Hope.
Someone said hope. Very peaceful, almost ethereal.
Yeah, tranquil, very tranquility, I guess.
Very good. Yeah, calming,
love,
intimate, love. Yes, exactly. All of
happy
these
ending.
Words.
Happy ending. Yeah.
Happy ending. Great. All of these words are very
calming.
Very calming. Good. Yeah. Excellent. Yeah. So this is the singing style. Again, I'm giving you all music that is in the bright major mode. If this were a little bit darker. Different feeling to it, but it's still a singing melody and it's still very calming and quite content. And so these are the three topics that I want to talk about today, because there's a different things that we can do as composers to change the mood, the atmosphere, the effect, and even hint at certain things to our listeners. And so we will move on unless there are any questions or comments. All right, cool. So we will look at now the role-playing game. The role-playing game, if you've never played a role-playing game, that's okay. RPGs are video games that are modeled after Dungeons and Dragons. And I'm pretty sure we all know at least someone who has played Dungeons and Dragons. D&D is based off of the Tolkien-esque fantasy, like the Lord of the Rings. They are games traditionally, outside of the video game, people would sit at a table, they would have dice, they would create a character, and then they would role play. They would adopt that character. They would act and talk and function like that character while they were playing the game. Role-playing games as a video game are very much modeled after the D&D style, but they are also modeled after movies, because these games usually take anywhere between 10 and 100 hours to play. Back in the 1980s, when you played The Legend of Zelda or Final Fantasy I, you might be playing the game for about 10 to 15 hours, but you are a character, you move the character around, you explore the world, you talk to people, you go on adventures, you take quests, you go into shops. I mean, it's basically like watching and playing through a movie. I always tell people, imagine that you're playing the game Harry Potter, and you are Harry Potter, and you do all of the things that the book says. What you're doing is you're playing a role-playing game based off of Harry Potter. Very similar to movies, characters have their own themes. And I did ask that you would watch a video on some of the leitmotifs or the themes that we associate from the Star Wars franchise, because the Star Wars is a very, very popular franchise to talk about when it comes to leitmotifs. Every character is usually musically represented, even though they might be off screen. When you hear, they're either talking about the Empire or they're talking about Vader, because that is his melody. And these are, for lack of a better term, called leitmotifs. And so role-playing games often also use leitmotifs to represent their characters. So the game that I'm going to be talking about for the rest of the next hour is Final Fantasy VI. This came out for the Super Nintendo in 1994. I was just a young lad. And this game completely mesmerized everyone that I knew. The graphics for back in the 90s were very, very high quality. But the music was incredibly complicated for its time. The soundtrack won an award for best music in a multitude of platforms. And the game usually takes about 14 hours to complete, 40 hours to complete. There are 14 characters that you can actually play as. And each character, as you watch and you see the movie unfold and do a lot of reading, because they didn't have any voiceover, so you had to read everything. But the characters have a very complicated story, each one of them has a very complicated history. And the composer, Nobuo Uematsu, wrote primary, secondary, and in some cases, tertiary leitmotifs for each character. And so the leitmotif, as I mentioned, is a term that we use for lack of a better term, a character theme. But this is a device that was concocted by a German opera composer named Richard Wagner. He was a very famous opera composer of the 19th century. And he's really the guy who came up with this idea of a musical melody or a theme or some kind of musical identity for a character that would undergo various transformations to either reflect, comment, or foreshadow certain elements of the drama. So you have this interesting kind of relationship between the drama and the music, that when you combine them together, you're not just saying that the music reflects the drama, but you're saying that the music and the drama work together to create deeper meaning and a deeper dramatic, or as we like to say, musico-dramatic affect for the listener. And we actually kind of see this in a video game from 1994. So the graphics that you see on the screen is just from one scene that takes place halfway through the game. Again, it looks kind of archaic by modern standards, but this was quite amazing and impressive back in the 90s. It's a very simple story. There is an evil emperor and an evil empire. The emperor is right here. He's on his he's lying down because he just got killed, or he's about to die. His name is Emperor Gestal, and he's trying to take over the world using magic, using his second in command, who is right over here. His name is Kefka. He's just an evil demonic clown. And in the scene that you're looking at right now, the second in command Kefka just killed his emperor so he can assume all power for himself. So very much like Star Wars, there's an evil empire and there's a resistance movement, and they're called the Returners. And the Returners are the characters that you adopt. So you are basically trying to defeat the Emperor and the Empire throughout the entire game. What we're going to do is we're going to look at a few of these character themes, because as we as we're introduced to characters, we're immediately imposed a particular character. And I don't mean character like literary character. I mean a musical topic. We listen to the music and we already know what kind of person we're dealing with. But just like a good composer, they hint at other things that are deeper within this character. And then later on, that particular theme undergoes a transformation to change and reflect and work with the drama. So one of the characters we're looking at, his name is Locke. He is a treasure hunter. They all call him a thief, but he's a treasure hunter. He's the second character we're introduced to in the game. And his job is to rescue Terra. She's another character. She's in danger of getting kidnapped by the Emperor. We're introduced with his leitmotif in the background. And there are two sections, and we're going to listen to them quickly in a second. Section A refers to Locke in his present. And so he comes in all heroic and he's going to do the good thing. And we're going to see him rescue someone. And so all of the music that we listen to will be reflecting this heroic character. The B section is actually alluding to a past that we don't know about yet. And we find out that later on in the game. So I'm going to show you the introduction to when we finally meet Locke. And again, this is the game that you'll be playing. The character walks through the door, that's Locke. And he's talking to a guy who's going to tell him to go rescue this woman who is in danger of getting kidnapped. So if we listen to this music again, what kind of instruments can you recognize in this A section that we're hearing?
Drums.
Good, drums.
What else? Trumpet.
Trumpet. That's pretty much it. Drums and trumpet. There's a lot of brass. But there's a specific kind of drum. It's that snare drum in the back. And if we remember from the first topic that we looked at, snare drums are indicative of a march. And so when we listen to this, we hear, even though it's not technically a march per se, I guess, it still reminds us of drums, because snare drums are a sign of the drum, especially when you get the rhythms that they're playing. So already off the bat, we hear instruments and rhythms that indicate some kind of march. It's also a march tempo. I mean, it's not too fast, it's not too slow, it's very brisk, a brisk march. One, two, da, da, da. And then also. We are in the key of a G major, and so we are in a bright, bright key. The melody uses a lot of skips that outline chords. So that opening, da, 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 that interval of a fourth is often used in marches and in fanfares. And then we get this section that goes, that melody had that skip that outlined a triad. So when we combine these different elements, what we actually hear is fanfare rhythms and march rhythms, because the snare drum, I'm going to play this again, but the snare drum, you're going to be hearing playing a march rhythm, but every once in a while you'll hear the melody playing fanfare triplets, especially right over here. And then here again. So da-da-da-da, da-da-da-da. As a matter of fact, if you think about the opening of Star Wars, we get da-da-da-da. So when we get that opening with those rhythms, we hear fanfares, especially when you combine those rhythms with that interval of a fourth. So da-da-da-da indicates a fanfare. This is a very specific topic, because when we combine march and fanfare together, we get what is referred to as the hero topic. It is a very, very, very overdone cliche, but it works, and that's why it's a cliche. The hero topic goes way, 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 way back. We even hear instances of heroism in some of the Mozart symphonies, and they really not necessarily were trying to portray a person that we know, but when we hear it, we get this overall affect of heroism. Pride, adventure, heroism, all these words combine when we hear this kind of music. So let's listen one more time. You're going to hear brass and strings. You'll hear snare drums in the background playing a little march rhythm. And you'll also hear the melody itself using intervals and rhythms that are often associated with the fanfare. Gotta love that cymbal crash too. So are there any questions on this, the idea of blending the march and the fanfare to create the hero? Well, as I mentioned, Locke has a two section melody. We have the melody that we just heard, but then we hear a B section. The B section is a little bit different. And as I mentioned a second ago, it alludes to the fact that he has a past that we are unfamiliar with yet. So we don't know anything about his past. We're just exposed to the fact that this guy is going to rescue someone. But this B section is a little bit different than what we were listening to a second ago. How is it different? What instruments are highlighted in this section?
Strings?
Mostly strings. As a matter of fact, there are no brass in this section. It's only strings, and the snare drum is still keeping its march rhythm in the background. But there are no trumpets. There's nothing that we would expect if this were a fanfare of anything. So yes, drums. Someone said that in the chat. Drums and strings. Good. It's the same tempo that we were listening to a second ago. But this is the indicator. Does this music sound like it is bright, or does it sound like it's more of a darker color? Take a listen one more time. What do you think?
Darker.
It's a darker color. Good. It's a much darker color because the composer travels to the minor mode. So instead of going, it's a little bit darker. So we have this overall effect. The melody also doesn't use any skips anymore. So rather than using this overall skip that outlined the triad, which we associate with marches and more often fanfares, everything is emphasizing the step. So there are only two skips in that melody. It's actually much more singable if you think about it, because all the notes are so close together. The rhythm of this melody is, very simple, right? These notes are much longer than these the rhythms that we were listening to a second ago, especially that we get rid of that da 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 fanfare. And so this is much more of a singing style mixed with the march. And because it's darker, we get this kind of mournful kind of melody. It doesn't sound incredibly sad because it's still part of this overall major piece that we were listening to a second ago. But this one section sounds almost more like a lamenting, a mournful kind of singing melody. Then we go back to completely different topics and different effects for the listener within this piece of music that's only a minute long, because after a minute, it loops back to the beginning. So what we're doing is, what the composer is doing is he's mixing topics. He's mixing the march with the singing style. And instead of being a very upbeat in the major key, he combines it with the minor. And so you go from this prideful adventure hero to something that's a little bit more introspective and a little bit more like does not compute, right? We were just in this bright major and now all of a sudden we're in this singing minor, and then we go back to major. So there's a little bit of a dissonance here with the way these two sections work. And there's a reason for it, because Locke has, just like every other character in this game, he has a tragic history. And we're gonna see that in a second. I'll show it to you. When he was younger, he was engaged to a girl named Rachel, and they went off on an adventure, and she fell almost to her death. And when she came out of her coma, she couldn't remember anything. And so the music that accompanies this scene where Locke is remembering his past is the same melody that we just heard, but it's undergone a transformation. And we're gonna talk about how the music is transformed in a second. But before we do that, let's just watch the scene. We're about to see the player entering a house, and Locke is going to recall the tragic history of his past. Presentation that we than the melody that we were listening to a second ago, but it turns out that when he went off into the sad face, exactly. So basically what happens in the game is that he tries to go off because her father kicks him out of the house because now she has amnesia. He goes off to try and find her a cure, and while he's gone, he finds out that the emperor or the empire invaded the city, torched her house, and she died in the fire, or he thought she died, but she just slipped into a deeper coma out of which she never comes out. So everything is quite sad here, obviously, as you can hopefully hear it in the music. But more importantly, all of the fanfare and all of the march is completely gone from this presentation of the melody. What instruments can you hear mostly in this opening?
Strings,
good.
Harp, flute.
That's pretty much it. Strings, harp, and flute. It's either flute or oboe. Regardless, it's some kind of a high woodwind. It's much slower. It makes sense to be slow, right? Because this is supposed to portray some kind of sadness. It is no longer in the key. Instead, it is in the minor key. So if we listen again, it's much darker. And also, the melody uses mostly steps, because if we listen to the band or the melody from his main melody, his leitmotif, Locke's theme, it sounds like this. We have those skips that imply some kind of fanfare and heroism. But here, the melody is much more singable, and it has many more steps than skips. The skips that are used are much more expressive. And also, the melody has much longer and simple rhythms. And so if we were to figure out what topic is being used, would we say fanfare, singing style, or the hero topic, or the march? What would you think?
Singing style.
Absolutely. That's 100% singing style. And it's a lament, right? He's lamenting his past. And so when we heard his original theme, we had that one dark moment. To ourselves, why would you insert this darker, more singing, mournful melody in the middle of this overall impressive and heroic march? And that's because the composer is foreshadowing and alluding to this scene that connects us further with his history, which, if you think about it, it's not as prideful and heroic. It's much more of a somber style. And so it gives us this affect of sorrow and loss through all of these different topics merging together. Now on your screen is the much more interesting, at least to me, the more interesting and complicated transformational procedure that we have. If you can't read music, that's fine, because I'm going to point to things and play them for you. But this is the interesting kind of way that the composer links these two melodies together and foreshadows at the same time. Locke's melody, played in Forever Rachel, which we just heard a second ago, that sounds like this. But the way he starts Forever Rachel is not with just the melody. He starts with an introduction. That introduction is based off of the transition from Locke's original theme that sounds like this. And then he goes to that dark perception. What's interesting to me is that the idea that transition before going into the darker section descends. So we hear, and then again, to suggest that we're diving deeper into the character's psyche, right? On the surface, he's this, you know, this funny, happy-go-lucky hero, but as you dive deeper into the character's subconscious, he actually has a troubled past. And so that exact melody that we hear during the transition is what begins Forever Rachel. But in this case, it rises. Right before finally going into the main theme. And so instead of starting with the theme, he chooses to use this little fragment of a transition, but instead of lowering in pitch as we dive deeper into the character, now he's immersed in his sorrow, and so we hear the same melody rising in intensity. And then finally, get the main melody. So these are very subtle ways that the composer is able to choose what little rhythm on the melodic content he wants to start with, but it makes a lot more sense, right? We start with this melody, and in Forever Rachel, it's much more lamenting. But instead of starting with it, he starts with this transition passage from the original melody. So it's a very complicated way of organizing his music. That way, exactly, it's the singing style, right? Because it's more like a crying out, much more of a lament that we hear in this passage.
And very clever too.
Oh, it's very clever. It's very, I mean, this is what composers like Beethoven or Haydn or Bach or any of the composers that we can consider to be art music. It's the same kind of style. It's the same kind of compositional techniques. And as a video game, because you are directly interacting with the medium, you know, you can compare that with a movie. You watch a movie, you're sitting there, you're letting the movie happen to you, right? But when you're playing a game like this, you are interacting with it. So it's a much more personal interaction with the player and with the audience than it would be if it was just simply background music. Any questions on this? What's really fascinating, I want you to take a listen to this B section really quick of the original melody, because this little idea comes back. This three notes seems like a stupid, arbitrary little, just three notes, whatever. This three note motive is actually what links every single character in this game. For instance, other characters that are quite important to the plot is King Edgar and his brother Sabin. Very similar to Locke, they share a common tragic history. When they were young, they inherited the kingdom when their father died of an illness. And so what they did after the father died to figure out who would become king is that they toss a coin in the air and they let that decide who would become the king. Edgar won, and so Sabin left to pursue his own life, and Edgar inherited the kingdom. We later discover in the game, and so does Sabin, that Edgar used a double-sided coin so he would win, because he knew his brother hated the politics surrounding the kingdom, and he knew his brother wanted to be free. So Edgar kind of bites the bullet and kind of sabotage it, so he becomes king, but his brother's free to live his own life as he chooses. These two characters are represented musically very similar to Locke with two melodies. The first one is called Figaro Castle, and just like Locke, it contains two main sections, an A section and a B section. This is Edgar here, and this is Sabin. And if we listen to the music, we're going to hear very similar topics that we heard when we were listening to the earlier music associated with Locke. What instruments can you make out mostly?
Trumpet, violins,
mm-hmm. A lot of strings,
horns,
good horns. So brass, trumpets, anything else?
Drum.
Yeah, we get those big bass drums. Good, very good. So when you combine all of that in a moderate tempo, in a very bright, when you combine all that together, oh, someone said something in the chat.
Synthesizer. Question mark?
Yeah, all those strings that you're listening to are basically MIDI approximations. So it kind of sounds like a synthesized string. But these are often, the melody that we're listening to uses a lot of skips. Sorry, huh? These skips are outlining triads. Again, they're often used in fanfares. And we also hear da 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 da, that triplet da 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 is very, very subtle. We only hear it once, but it's used at a climactic point, and that's what indicates this idea of a fanfare. But we also hear ta 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 ta, which sounds very similar to march rhythms as well. fanfare. Ba 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 ba, bum bum bum. But later on. When we listen to the B section, you're going to hear rhythms that sound like marches, but much more drawn out. Ta 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 ta. Ta 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 ta. Well, me, if we were to play that faster, ta 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 ta, we get a march. So he's taking this march rhythm and stretching it out, adding these fanfare rhythms, and you get a blend of a march and a fanfare, once again, giving this overall effect of a dignified or regal kind of representation of these two characters. Now this B section, you might notice, does not have any horns. It's mostly strings. So as I mentioned, these two characters, just like Locke, have a secondary leitmotif. Their secondary leitmotif is called coin toss, and it's when we watch a flashback of the two characters after their father, they learn of his death, they go to the roof and they flip a coin, the coin's right here. The music is a sad or different, more melancholy or somber version of the same melody that we just heard. But as you would expect, the instrumentation has been changed, the tempo has been changed, the key has been changed, and we get a brand new melody to further explain what happened when they were younger. And so this the scene that we're about to watch is during the flashback. Sabin is here, he hasn't been to the castle in many, many years, and the camera will pan down, and that's the beginning of the flashback that he's having. There's eventually a coin toss where they toss a coin. right here. Oh. So just like Locke, we've taken away all the heroic topics and signs that are associated with heroism and regality, and we have transformed the affect for the listener. And so what instruments do you hear primarily in the beginning?
Percussion, and someone said maybe flute?
Maybe, yeah, so it's definitely flute.
Strings,
good, yes. So this is actually it's a MIDI approximation of a muted guitar. But for the most part, there isn't as much emphasis on percussion. There's a lot more somber, warm colors. So we get strings, flutes, and muted guitar.
Someone's wondering, like, what's a muted guitar?
A muted guitar is like if you get an electric guitar and you take away all the distortion and you give it this kind of warm color that we're listening to, that's what we call muted, because you can get a lot of different sounds on an electric guitar. Think about heavy metal with all that loud distortion. You remove all of that and you get this kind of warm sound that sounds like this. Much slower, and it's also a little bit more, I mean, we haven't really emphasized a whole lot of darkness. It's actually the same scene that the Wee Girl Castle was in, but if you take a listen, there's a lot of cadences or ending points that outline
Dr. Anatone, someone said, I thought it was like those effects that some keyboards have.
A muted guitar?
I'm not sure. A muted guitar? Yay or nay? Yes.
Yeah, you can, if you have a keyboard that has the possibility of using, of creating many, many, many sounds, one of them would be a muted guitar. You could also have a distorted guitar. Sometimes they call it a jazz guitar. I mean, there's many different kinds of guitar sounds that we can create on digital keyboards, and they are named after actual instruments or actual effects that we can create on other instruments. So are there any other questions? Again, this melody has a, or this coin toss has a brand new melody. Section is based off of a brand new melody that we never really heard in the opening of Figaro Castle. Rhythms, as we would expect with more sad and more introspective music, uses simple rhythms and the longer notes. So very similar to Locke, we get this lamenting singing style. So we've replaced the heroic topic with the singing style, even though it's basically the same music. And again, we get this kind of mournful loss to the listener that we didn't have in the other piece. Now again, this is the more interesting way that the composer is able to do it. The melody in Coin Toss, in Figaro Castle, this section right here, is what we hear at the beginning of Coin Toss. It's this second phrase of the Figaro Castle that da 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 is what expands into the B section of Figaro Castle. So Figaro Castle begins. And that's expanded into that is what brings us to a brand new melody in Coin Toss. So Coin Toss begins the same way, but takes this little B section that never really went anywhere in Figaro Castle. And in this time, it leads us to this brand new melody that continues to explain the backstory of these two characters. And what's even more fascinating is although this new section of coin toss that I played a second ago that sounds like this. It sounds like a completely unrelated and brand new melody. But if I were to take this right here from the coin toss, and if I were to take that phrase that I just played and remove the first two notes, I get this. And if we compare that to the second melody, we get this. So although it is a brand new melody, it is based off of taking four notes from this section and turning it into something new. So it's still related. As a matter of fact, it develops into this brand new melody that we've never heard before, but it's accompanying this flashback, which is further explaining the history of these two characters. This is a very, very important process for composers known as developing variation. You get this idea and you change it and you develop it into new ideas. That way everything is related and not unrelated to each other. Any questions so far or comments on this music? All right. Which brings us to the last hero that we're going to look at in this game, Cyan. Cyan is a warrior, he's a master swordsman, and he's the retainer to the King of Doma. He's basically the king's second hand man. He's very respected by his king, he's loved by his family, and we're introduced to him in the game when the empire attacks his kingdom. Although he repels them the first time, the emperor eventually poisons the water supply at the castle, and everyone except for Cyan dies. Cyan sees his king get poisoned. He sees his wife and his son all killed within the blink of an eye. It's very, very, very sad, obviously. Cyan is introduced the way you would expect a hero to be introduced, especially in this game. We hear very heroic and very, very march and fanfare and regal kind of music. As you would expect, we get the same kinds of styles and the same kind of topics that we heard in the opening of the other two characters. The instruments here are not trumpets, but we use a native flute that's actually native to the composer's homeland in Japan. I can't remember the name of the instrument, but it is a MIDI approximation of a particular flute that's native to Japan. Music, it is also in a mode that is associated very often with battle or with regality, the Dorian mode. You get this really cool interest of this cool blending of dark and bright. So. just like the other two characters who are associated with the crown, we have a lot of melodies, or a lot of skips rather, that outline a fourth. The opening melody begins with a fourth, just like we get. But the B section is what I'm more interested in, because the B section is much brighter. Than the other two pieces that we were listening to. When we looked at Locke, his B section was dark because it links him to his past. That other section that we saw in Figaro Castle was also a little bit dark, and it also linked us to his past. This is a very bright melody. It implies Lydian harmonies as well. So it actually gives you a really, really interesting sense of pride and dignity, and again, this regality that's associated with the crown with all these harmonies. What's really interesting is that we get this cool sense of foreshadowing with irony, because as we know, as I just mentioned, Cyan witnesses the death of everyone that he loves in about 5 minutes. Everyone gets poisoned. And later on in the game, Cyan travels with your companions through what's called the Phantom Forest. The Phantom Forest brings us to a phantom train, which departs the souls to the afterlife. And so, as you can see on the screen, when Cyan finally gets to the train, he is able to see the souls of his wife and child being brought away into the afterlife. The music that's associated with the Phantom Forest isn't necessarily Cyan's second theme, but it's so closely related to his character, because he has to go on this journey to see his loved ones one last time before they finally go to the afterlife. So it's not his second leitmotif, but it's very strongly associated with him as a character. And when you look at the musical similarities, you actually hear this section that I just played a second ago. Notes. Da, da, da. We actually hear that in the Phantom Forest. So it's a very, very subtle connection, but this, E, is the same three notes that we heard with Cyan. And so you can see on the screen a very complicated way of connecting all of this music. Cyan's theme is here on the first section that we see. We get three notes played twice. We get this, this, and then we get this. So the first image is inverted. Instead of going up and then down, we get a statement that goes down and then up. That three-note idea is played backwards and flipped like a mirror. So instead of this, instead of getting this, it's flipped. This is a process of a compositional technique called retrograde inversion. Retrograde means I'm playing my notes backwards. So instead of this, I'm going to play this little fragment right here. Take a listen. I'm going to play it backwards. And now, instead of going down and then up, I'm going to do a mirror image and go up and down. Take a listen. And now we get his B section in Cyan's theme. And then later on, when we're traveling to the forest to see his child and his wife departing forever, we get this very, very expressive three-note fragment played twice. It sounds like someone's crying out to God saying, like, why did you take my family? And it is very, very subtle. And it's very expressive, especially when considering that this is all done in 1994 on a Super Nintendo.
Somebody asked, well, said, actually, I think I'll start with the first one. So would this be considered polyphony?
So polyphonic texture means you're using multiple melodies at the same time. So it's not necessarily polyphonic texture, but what we're doing is we're taking a melody and we are transforming it multiple ways, but we always hear only one melody really played at the same time.
And someone else said as a comment, Aguilera, Christina, may have sampled. I hear I Kept My Promise.
Oh, I don't know that song, but cool. She may have sampled. I'll have to check that out. Maybe she sampled some Final Fantasy. Any other questions before I get to my last point, which is, I promise, is very brief. As I mentioned, every one of these characters in Final Fantasy VI has some kind of tragic backstory. Everyone, and these are all the characters that you're able to play as. And so again, the developers of this game had to basically write a movie script with very complicated histories and then make it so you could play it on the Super Nintendo. The music not only enhances, but also is in dialogue with the drama. Now, the characters that I just showed you all have very similar backstories where on the surface they look like they're fine people and they probably are, right? They're very good and they're very happy-go-lucky on the surface, but in their deep psyche, they have this really awful tragedy that they've been carrying with them for their entire lives. When we listen to the most important sections of their music, you get the same three notes. And it's not just like, yeah, okay, you hear three notes everywhere. You hear it everywhere at the beginnings and ends of phrases played at the most expressive way. So this is a sample. We're going to listen to Locke's B section, then Edgar and Sabin, and then Edgar and Cyan, and then Cyan's second theme, and then a character I didn't get to, but we'll also hear the tragic three-note motive. And then the very last motive, in a tune called Dark World, this is the music that you hear halfway through the game when you think everyone is dead that you ever knew, and the music while you're exploring the world trying to find your friends, the music you hear climaxes again on three notes in the very, very high register. So this is a very quick minute-long sample that shows you all of the, not even all, just one, two, three, four, six instances. There are many, many more where this three-note motive comes back over and over again through the entire soundtrack.
Thank you.
And so it's a very, very subtle way that a composer is able to create unity in the soundtrack that's enhancing the story that we're playing through. And because of that, you get this soundtrack that has 61 individual pieces of music, and yet they all have this really interesting connection. So although you're listening to 61 different pieces, they're all connected. And that's really what a composer, when they're writing art music, is really interested in doing, creating unity. You don't want your music and your ideas to sound like a jumbled mess. You want your ideas to sound united, unified. You want cohesion everywhere. And it's subtle. Maybe we don't notice it. Heck, I didn't notice it until I started really researching the soundtrack about 3 years ago. No one has come up with this. No one has seen this. No one has really dove really deep into the soundtrack like this. This is a very, very popular soundtrack and a very popular video game. People have written about the music and the story for years. But when you really look at the craftsmanship that the composer has when creating 61 individual pieces of music and trying to make it sound like they're all united, you get this three-note motive. And all the characters are united by tragedy. And this three-note idea is used to show and bring the listener and the player into their tragic history. And so that's really what I'd like for you to take from this, is transformation of a melody to show one character and their backstory, but then uniting all of these characters' melodies through this three-note idea that on the surface we might not even recognize, but in our subconscious, it's what brings the entire soundtrack together. Are there any questions? Because that's pretty much what I have for today.
I just had a comment. One of my favorite composers is Hans Zimmer, and I think I've listened to just about every song that he's ever made, and I've noticed when he does movie soundtracks, I'll catch some of the notes repeating in other songs, just maybe in a like slower tempo, and I always caught it, but I didn't necessarily understand how he did it. So your presentation tonight really kind of gave me insight on that.
Oh, good, I'm glad. And you, the way also, I mean, start paying attention to topics too, because I mean, the idea that an idea like a three-note group or a phrase might transform, and you might hear it in a different setting, but you know, the topic is changed or the contour is changed, that really will be a much more rewarding experience to watch the movie, because you're kind of conversing with the composer, you know, you're interacting more with the movie.
Right, thank you.
You're welcome. Anyone else?
I know, personally, I really love this. I had no idea that there were transformations within one particular character, and it's simple yet so complex with those very few notes, just changing those notes slightly and adding some more instrumentation, or either different ways of creating the melody and the,
right.
Well, altering the melody to create different rhythms. It's just really fascinating.
Oh, I'm glad. Yeah, it's what makes, I think, one of the reasons why his music is so well loved, is that it is connected. We might not realize how connected it is, but he also has this uncanny ability of just writing fantastically catchy melodies. I mean, he wrote the music for Final Fantasies 1-9, and some of the music for Final Fantasy 10. So I mean, his entire output is hours and hours and hours worth of music,
and well thought out, we see.
Yeah, and I mean, and also, I mean, this stuff is arranged and performed on the concert stage. His music is performed by amateurs and professionals worldwide. So I mean, this is a fun music to listen to, but also experiencing it while you play the game really kind of helps you have a different level of engagement with the game that you're playing.
Can definitely see that. Oh wait, there's something in the chat.
Oh
someone said wow.
Oh,
okay. And there's another one. Final Fantasy is an amazing game. Last time I played it, it was when I was in middle school.
Play it again.
Yeah, understanding it on a whole different level. We talked about Coelia and how those subjective experiences really enhance something. So definitely play it again. See if you feel and think differently than you did when you were in middle school. And someone else said, it was interesting about the different topics and the effects they make. Yeah, that's true. I agree.
I'm glad. You'll when you're aware of this kind of thing, you'll start to see it in literally every music that you listen to and every film that you watch, the more you pay attention. And it's a little bit more rewarding.
And we will certainly be doing that for our analytical essay.
Oh, fantastic. Thought I could help.
And they said they make me want to learn about the topics and the effects.
Oh, good.
That's fantastic.
Excellent.
So did anyone have anything else for Dr. Anatone?
Now, I don't have time because unfortunately I have to go and then pick up my wife. However, I have I made one more slide in case I had a little bit more time. I don't, but I just want to show you something really quickly, really quick. The villain in the game, the Emperor, he has his own music. And what you hear when you listen to the music is that it is a very, very perverted version of the fanfare and the march. The music is dark, like very dark. The music is slow. It is very dissonant and chromatic. And so what you're doing is you're taking the march and the fanfare and perverting them. And when we do this, we actually get the sense of a villain topic or the anti-hero. So when we listen to the main melody, the snare drums in the background, ta 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 ta. You're still getting fanfare, but it's not da 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 da. It's da 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 da. So it's really, really drawn out, and you get this dark harmonies. You get dissonant chromatic harmonies as well. So instead of using the march and the fanfare to promote regality or dignity or heroism, you destroy it, you pervert it, you create this impending doom kind of effect to the listener by perverting an otherwise heroic topic. So you combine the hero topic with irony, right? You make it ironic. Instead of having what you would expect with heroes, you make it more distorted and therefore create what we refer to in the media industry as the villain or in the anti-hero topic. So that's why Darth Vader's march is still a march, but it's very dark. And so you get this imperial march, this very kind of twisted march that you immediately associate with villainy instead of heroism. So I didn't get to go over it too in detail, but I just wanted to share that with you as well. So when you're listening to films, you might start noticing people taking ideas that are ironic and they still splice them together to create this cognitive dissonance in the listener so they can either create their own opinions or their own theories about what you're watching. And it really makes a more of an interactive experience when you're playing games or when you're watching film.
You're getting some thank yous as well as thank you. That was great. Thank you. It was really engaging.
I'm glad.
And can I just say something real quick?
Yeah.
I can't remember if it's Haydn or Wagner, and I want to say the piece is called Seasons.
Oh yeah. The
Yes. Even though it's about, I think that's the right piece. Even though it's about the seasons, I hear the villains and the heroes in it. Do you know what I mean?
Oh,
like
yeah,
when
yeah.
winter comes and
yeah, and I'm not sure if you heard or if you read the poetry, but when Vivaldi wrote The Four Seasons, he actually based the music off of poetry that he wrote. So you might notice heroes and villains, you're putting together this kind of story, but interestingly enough, the composer actually had a story in mind, and in the music, he even wrote the poetry above the lines. So the next time you listen Wonderful. To the music, see if you can find the poetry, because you'll actually see what the composer had in mind.
Thank you.
Sure.
You have another comment. Thank you. Hold on. I think I'm muted.
No, I can hear you.
I have two devices on. Thank you. I learned so much tonight. So yeah. That was not for me. That was from one of our learners. But yeah, fantastic. Thank you so much for coming, Dr. Anatone.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me.
Oh yeah, it was our pleasure, definitely. And check your email and pass that. Everyone else, just gonna hang on the line. We're going to have Dr. Anatone leave us. Lots more thank yous. And I have a quick little thing for you guys related to next week. And then that's it for class tonight.